Those Old Testament stories help us to realize God's not limited to stats and facts and all of that. So even when you read about Abraham and the Bible says he didn't stagger at the promises of God, he didn't consider his own body dead. You know, he didn't consider those facts. Those were realities. But he says, I'm not going to focus on that. My confidence is going to be that the God who has promised, he is able to perform that which he has said.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast. Helping families thrive.
Hey John, something I tried to drill into my boys as they were growing up was kind of a healthy identity in Christ, right? Mm-hmm. That's where it all starts. And boy, as parents, that's the one thing you have to do with your kids as best as you can. And they need to know that their worth isn't in their behavior or in their activities, sports, whatever. Their identity as Christians is in Christ, and I'm convinced we adults need to hear that from time to time as well. Mm-hmm. It's so easy to drift and look for security in things outside of God. It might be the nice car, the nice house, the title, whatever. But left on our own, we'll always struggle with insecurity and lean into those things that are the more worldly applications rather than knowing who we are in Christ. And today, we're going to have a great chat with someone who will help you really understand your confidence, not in yourself, but in your relationship with Christ and what the Lord can do with that kind of strong, healthy confidence.
Yeah, we can have peace apart from all the external stuff that we think is going to satisfy. And Deborah Pegues, she's got a background in the corporate world. She's a Bible teacher who speaks internationally. She's a really popular guest here at Focus and returns today for a conversation about a book that she wrote called 30 Days to a Stronger, More Confident You, Secrets to Bold and Fearless Living. And you can click the link on your screen or call 800-A-FAMILY to get your copy.
And I want to welcome our live audience. Our interns are here for the summer. It's great to have them here. And we're going to do a little Q&A, I think, at the end here. So be thinking of questions to ask Deborah. And of course, Deborah, it's good to have you back.
Thank you so much. It's just a delight. And I'm just honored at the opportunity to be here.
You, let me start here. You seem like a ball of energy. Is this how you are all day long?
I am. My husband says I'm like that hummingbird. He has some pet hummingbirds, and they just buzz around all the time.
I could see that. Yeah. I mean, you're just fun to be with.
Well, thank you. I enjoy life.
Yeah, that's good. Where do you think that came from?
Romans 8:28. You know I'm a walking Bible. But everything works together for my good. I mean, the stuff that just that I can never figure out. I mean, some things happened even on this trip that I can't figure out what the good was, but I'm like, in the scheme of things, when it's all said and done, something good's going to come out of that.
That is a thriving attitude, though, but not many people possess it.
Well, I know. That's why I'm on a mission to make sure that people do. I don't tolerate disappointment very long and sadness, because why would I, when God has allowed it? Every day ordained for me was already written in his book.
Yeah.
How about that?
I mean, it really is the basis for what we're talking about here.
Yeah.
In your great book, 30 Days to a Stronger, More Confident You, one of the things you say you have to do first is to diagnose your level of insecurity.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know. I mean, John, do you feel insecure in some areas?
All the time around you.
No, I'm serious.
No, I think, yeah, I think back to being a teenager, which is kind of where it really hit a high level.
Everybody's insecure
and
as a
teenager.
And it
just continues.
About something.
Yeah.
But it never really leaves, I don't think, for a lot of us.
No,
so,
it doesn't.
So what's that check that you recommend people do to say, how insecure are you?
Well, first of all, I say, let's just talk about what insecurity is, because that means to be not sure. Okay, that's what the word means, not sure. Hmm. So we all have some area of our lives where we are not sure of our adequacy. And so I just say, okay, it's learned behavior. It really is learned behavior. You can learn to be confident, but we learn through what we were told as a child or through authority figures or by failing and somebody poking fun at us about that. So it's all learned. But the thing is, it can be unlearned. And that's what I like. And it's really not about developing self-confidence, because I'm adamantly opposed to that concept.
Yeah.
Self-confidence. Think about that. Confidence means with trust.
Hmm.
Self-confidence means with trust in yourself.
Yourself, right.
That's not good. The Bible says he who trusts in himself is a fool. So I'm not trying to be a fool.
That's good.
Not trying to be a fool.
No, that's good. Yeah. I would also say insecurity seems to be rooted in comparison. I mean, that's a problem. And our culture is rife with comparison, right?
Absolutely.
What we drive, where we live, what job we have, who our friends are.
We're bombarded with it all day on commercials. Every commercial, and I consciously watch them now to look for that piece that says you're inadequate, you need something.
Right.
So every commercial says either you need this new car, or you need this type, you need whatever, so that you can now be acceptable or even superior. So we do that. So many people buy self-esteem. You know, I'm a CPA by training, and I oftentimes help people with their budgets. And I see people buy things so that other people esteem, so they can be esteemed. Because if I have that item and people esteem that, perhaps they'll esteem me.
Your finger's right on it. I mean, that's materialism,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, it is. It is.
Let's get the scripture in here. David, who we all adore and for different reasons, but King David, his brother was an example that you used in the book that talked about envy.
Yeah. Eliab, David's brother. When God told Samuel to anoint a king, the first thing Samuel did when he saw that tall, handsome Eliab, he said, "That's the one. He looks kingly." And God says, no, that's not it. Because later on, when it was time to fight Goliath, David came down to the battlefield, and we all know the story. But Eliab said, "What are you doing down here?" And everybody was running from the giant. But here's what I like about this story. Eliab's name meant God is my father. That's what his name means. But he was running from the giant. How many of us do that? We say God is our father, but we're afraid. We have this giant of insecurity that makes us act like God is not our father.
That is good.
We act like God is not our father. Just think about it. If we really embrace the truth that God is omniscient, you know, he knows everything, he's always present, and he's all powerful, and we have that spirit in us. You show up differently, Jim. You show up differently. You show up with confidence because it's not in yourself. You know that you have a spirit in you that knows everything. Now, you're not going to know everything, but you're going to know everything you need to know when you need to know it.
Yeah. And envy is one of the three symptoms that you state of insecurity.
Oh,
what are the other two?
Well, the other two are people-pleasing and workaholism. And let me just talk about that envy just a little bit, because people sometimes confuse that with jealousy.
Uh-huh.
But jealousy is rooted in fear. Jealousy says, "I'm afraid that you're going to take what I have." And that's a form of insecurity as well. But envy says, "I want what you have. And because I don't have it, I feel ill will towards you." So that's rooted in discontentment. We don't have to be insecure about what God has given us. You know, as a speaker, we sometimes compare, you know, or I'll look at people who are more popular than I am. They have huge followings. And I have to tell you this real quickly, because the other day I said, "I just don't have anybody. I'm my father isn't a famous preacher, or I don't have, I say I'm nobody's daughter." I was like, I stopped writing my tracks.
Right.
Oh, really?
That's what the Lord said. All people.
Yeah. "You're nobody's daughter." Like, "Oh, you're not God's daughter." Oh, okay. But we have to learn how to be content with what God, the track he's put us on. And you show up differently as well when you know that. Because now you can be secure knowing, if he's ordained my path, how can I fail?
You know what's a little scary about envy is it's in Galatians 5:19. It's the fruit of the other guy, the enemy.
Works of the flesh. Mm-hmm.
That's one of his attributes is envy.
Yeah.
Isn't that's horrible?
Well, it's horrible, but once we have to be conscious of it. So when I talk about assessing your level of insecurity, ask yourself, whom do I envy and why? Why do I envy that person? You know, but you asked me the question about what the other two were. People pleasing, insecure people like to please people because they're so afraid of being rejected and alienated. That's a big deal. We don't want to be rejected. We don't want to be isolated. We were born to be in community with people.
Yeah, Deborah, that one can be difficult because I think we can confuse that with the fruit of the Spirit, the right fruit, you know, where we want to be kind and considerate and people pleasing. How do you distinguish where that line should be and where it's unhealthy versus, you know, spiritually good?
Well, you look at your underlying motive. Why do I want to pay for lunch for you all the time?
So I think that's a great idea.
I think it's a great idea, too, if you're the one paying.
I heard you just offered to do that.
I think we're going to lunch today. But
because we want to be accepted.
Right.
Yeah.
And so if that's the motive, it's coming from the wrong place.
Right. So you have to look at the why. Why am I doing this? I'm always analyzing myself and questioning my motives. The psalm says God desires truth in the inward parts. I mean, don't lie to yourself. Just understand what's motivating you. you know, realist. That's in Psalm 51. God desires us to be truthful to ourselves. And so I have to ask myself that. I've done things in my life to ingratiate myself to people. I'll admit that. I wasn't just networking. I was really trying to get on their good side because they had great influence.
Right. So there was motivation there.
There was motivation there, but I forgot and have to remind myself that favor comes from God, not from my maneuvering, my ability to network effectively.
That is a huge statement. Mm-hmm. I think Christians as well as non-Christians get that one all muddled.
Well, we do. And that's why I'm adamant about people walking out the scriptures and making it a practical part of your life. Because there have been times I couldn't get favor with people. And it's like, oh, you're relying on them. You're so insecure and not believing God that you think that person can have influence on your career. And I can't. I'm everybody's father. I may not be everybody's Lord. God is everybody's father. So right. I don't have to get somebody who knows that person who knows that person. God's everybody's father.
When again, when you have that attitude, you're walking in peace.
Oh, now that's a good word.
Yeah.
Because peace is the opposite of insecurity. Because it's anxiety producing to be insecure. But once you just know and you just show up with a mindset that says, I'm more than a conqueror. I'm always winning. See, I mean, you need to say that because faith comes by hearing.
Yeah.
I need to say that I'm always winning.
Hmm. When you look at today's culture, how much of that is in play right now when you look at the church kind of bending to cultural appetites?
In almost every area, I am totally alarmed by the fact that now we seem to be more political than biblical. Think about that. Yeah. We're embracing things that are not always biblical because we're having alignment with a political party or whatever. And I'm concerned about that. I'm praying about it. I'm not voicing out a lot about it, but I know that prayer works. And so we're going to have to look at that. How are we influenced by the culture? Because we are. I think one of the greatest problems in the church is that the world has gotten in the church. The church is more worldly. And we haven't made the world more churchly, if that's a word. But we've become more worldly.
Yeah, and that's the point. Workaholism. This one's going to hit a lot of people. Idea that we derive our value, our worth out of how long we work in a given day.
Well, I'd have to say I'm the first one who would have to raise your hand. Every job I've ever been on, and I work for myself now, my car was the last one in the parking lot. And once I just asked myself, especially when I worked at a church and everybody thought I did a great job, and once somebody tells you to do a great job, you want to do a greater job so you can keep getting those accolades.
Yeah.
So knowing, you have to know when you're performance oriented. Again, it goes back to asking yourself why, what's motivating me? And I think I like the fact that everybody says she's a really hard worker and she has her stuff together. It's like, keep saying that.
Well, it makes you feel good.
It makes you feel good. Rather than just doing as unto the Lord, you know, you're working as unto the Lord. You want to be excellent because that's what God requires. No, I wanted to be excellent because everybody spoke of the fact that I was excellent. So it's like, let's keep that going. That's not good. It can drive you into, it messes with your health. Mm-hmm. You know, really it does. It'll mess with your relationship. Darnell finally put some guidelines. So, okay, on Fridays, you can't work late. That's date night. So whatever's going down, you have to be done about 5 o'clock.
Good for Darnell.
Yeah.
I like that. But you're saying this is all rooted in insecurity, whether it's envy, people pleasing, or workaholism, that these are to get accolades from others and feel better about yourself.
Right, feel better about yourself. And we do all kinds of things to feel better about ourselves. And we have to be honest about it. When you ask yourself, why am I doing this? You have to be honest about what your intention is.
Well, today on Focus on the Family, we have Deborah Pegues, and she's written this great book, 30 Days to a Stronger, More Confident You, Secrets to Bold and Fearless Living, and you can hear the energy and the passion in her voice. It's a great resource. Get your copy when you call 800-A-FAMILY or click the link on the screen. And Deborah, I'm wondering, is there a balance between God, and my part in what he's doing?
Absolutely. I love to tell everybody, we are in a supernatural relationship with God. Supernatural. I do what I'm supposed to do in the natural. He puts the super on it. Yes, I do what I'm supposed to do. I go to school. I get credentials. I work hard. But I don't let my faith rest there. Because there will come a time when your credentials and all of that will not be sufficient for the task. You can ask Daniel about that, who had the ability to interpret dreams. He was skilled in that, anointed to do that. But there came a time when he had to interpret a dream that the king couldn't even remember what the dream was. He wasn't skilled in telling people what you dreamed. He was skilled if you told him what it was, then I can tell you what it meant. And I learned from that. I learned from I read that story often because there will be many times there will be a gap between that, what's required and what you have available. That's where God comes in and put his supernatural impression upon it, his supernatural influence. So yes, we are in a supernatural partnership with God.
I love that. Yeah. I want to take us back to roadblock to confidence because you mentioned perfectionism is one of those roadblocks.
Yes.
I think I can relate to that, but give me the definition of perfectionism.
Well, perfectionism is that thing that says it's got to be exactly right, because it's really rooted in the fear of being criticized. So if I can be perfect, then nobody will criticize me. Then I won't have to be reminded that I have some vulnerabilities, some inadequacies. So we strive with that. That's what it's rooted in, the fear. That fear of being criticized is very real. And you know what? It just makes everybody crazy. And the interesting thing is, people relate to us on our vulnerabilities more than they do our perfections. And so it's really makes you more relatable when you can say, I'm not really good at that. You know, that's why I willingly confess to people. I have to still battle fear. It shows up. I don't like flying. I'm just, you don't want to sit by me. You might be embarrassed when we get turbulence. You probably won't know I'm a Christian. I'm cutting up. I'm not saying things.
You're like
I'm just cutting
woman,
up.
I was on a flight one time and this random stranger woman just grabbed my hand and said, can I hold your hand? I'm afraid of flying. I was like, okay. If that gives you some kind of comfort.
You know what would be funny, Jim, if you were that guy, because I did that with a guy, and he was, I'm black, he was white, and it was way, way back when. And I just grabbed his hand. I said, sir, I'm sorry, I'm going to need to hold your hand until we get airborne. I'll let you go when we get airborne.
It was fine, but I never knew that my gentlemanliness could be used in that way, but that was great. Deborah, I do want to come back to something you mentioned there, this idea of perfectionism. And then earlier we talked about doing everything unto the Lord with excellence.
Yes.
So what's that, you know, for the person that struggles to discern, where is it my perfectionism and where is it my excellence for the Lord?
Motive.
Okay.
Perfectionism is based on you seeing me in the best light. Excellence is about making sure that the project is done well. It really is about understanding that, because you have, listen, I ran a department once and I didn't want anybody messing up because I was the first woman to be in that department to head that kind of a thing. And one guy just kept messing up and I'm like, don't y'all make me look bad. Well, now was the goal there really to glorify God? No, it's like, don't make me look bad.
Okay, that's not a good motive.
That's not a good motive.
Yeah.
So again, that perfectionism, you have to understand why. What's driving that? I'm trying to make sure I am presented in the best light and that I don't get criticized, because it's excellent. It's excellent, but for the wrong reason. But when I just pursue doing something well, I want to do this as unto the Lord, because God deserves the best. Therein is the difference.
Yeah, how you, yeah. Attitude toward it.
Yes.
Explain why Christians today can find confidence in the promises that God made to ancient Israel. I love this question because so many friends of mine that relate to the New Testament struggle relating to the Old Testament. So how do those ancient stories actually play into this idea of confidence today?
Oh, my goodness. First of all, the entire Bible is relevant for everyday living. And I love the stories because they show us how to apply them. I like it when David showed up to fight Goliath and he was so proportionately inadequate. And Goliath says, I'm going to take your head off. And he says, oh, no, I'm going to take your head off. Because, see, you're coming to me, you know, with all your armor, but I'm coming in the name of the Lord. Listen, that gives you confidence. He understood it. He got it. He got it. He knew that God was bigger than the Goliath. He just knew it, because God is not limited by those kinds of things. And those Old Testament stories help us to realize God's not limited to stats and facts and all of that. So even when you read about Abraham and the Bible says he didn't stagger at the promises of God, he didn't consider his own body dead. You know, he didn't consider those facts. Those were realities. But he says, I'm not going to focus on that. My confidence is going to be that the God who has promised, he is able to perform that which he has said. That's good stuff. I read more Old Testament stories. I'll just go back and read that. I was just reading that the other day. He considered not the deadness of his wound. I'm like, oh, yes, because I'm doing a study on facts and reality and how we just get so stuck in our education and we don't expect things above that. We don't go outside of that realm, my experience, and especially women. We won't apply for a job unless we have all of the qualifications. They say a man will apply if he has half the qualifications.
Or less. I think that's fair.
Yeah, yeah. So those stories are relevant.
Hmm. You know, bringing it into a practical example, you had a challenging financing project, I think for a church.
Yes.
How did God show up? How did you rely on God? It's a modern day example of an Old Testament story, probably.
Well, several ways he showed up during that project, but we had a very complicated financing where they used what they call swap agreements. I wasn't really familiar with that aspect of financing, but I remember sitting around the table with a bunch of bankers who were trying to negotiate this $33 million loan, and I'm thinking, God, you got to show up big time today. But you know what? They asked me questions, and I didn't think I knew the answer, and I just say, God, help me, just help me. Mm-hmm. And he gave me a question that implied I knew the answer, just like the answer was way up here, and they said, oh, you're ahead of us. I certainly want to say, no, I am so far behind you, you're about to run into the back of me.
I love it.
Yeah, but God, he's done that consistently throughout my when I was in corporate America. Just showed up with responses and answers that I didn't know I had. And then I remembered that the scriptures say that he would not only bring things to your remembrance. But see, there were times it was never in my memory. I'm like, what about those times? Well, I read it says he will teach you and bring things into your remembrance. Huh. So God will teach you on the spot. You just got to get to that place where you expect him to do that. And you don't expect with anxiety. You show up with confidence, knowing like, whatever it is, he's going to bring me through this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's so good. Yeah. Let me press ahead with criticism. That's one of the things that are examples of good habits of confident people, that you're able to receive criticism,
yes.
Whether it's at home or in the workplace, kind of what you described earlier. You use an example from the Bible about Apollos and how he managed criticism. Tell us about that story.
Well, you know that he was a Jewish teacher, and it was Aquila and Priscilla that took him home and taught him a more excellent way, because he hadn't really been filled with the Spirit, but he had knowledge of the scriptures, and he was very powerful in that. And they said that he took him aside. Now, keep in mind, these were tent makers, blue-collar workers, who took this man aside and said, there's a more excellent way. Yeah. And he listened. I'm impressed with his humility. And it goes on to say that he was a great blessing to them. You see, we can always learn from somebody. Everybody brings something to the table. And so that's how you can increase other people's confidence. I like to try to find the gold in people and say, you bring something to the table. I know when people sometimes feel intimidated by me. I don't like that. So I try not to carry myself in a way that people think, oh, I'm not good enough to be with her, because trust me, you really are. And everybody brings something to the table. And I like to be able to say that.
Well, and you've managed people and you've worked in that corporate environment. Sometimes giving feedback isn't well received. I think you had another example where you were editing, I think, your company annual report, something went wrong.
Well, you see, and that's one of the great signs of habits of a confident person. They can not only receive criticism, and they can give that kind of feedback. And a lot of people just aren't comfortable, because they know how they will feel if somebody were to give them some feedback, so they don't give any as well. And so, yes, I did have an example where I hired a guy, and this is when I was doing the annual report, and it was my first year on the job, and I edited it, because I am a writer, so I was making it more succinct and making it grammatically correct. Oh, it started a furor. I'm telling you, everybody was upset. How dare you change my work? I'm thinking, don't you want it to be good?
Well, that's
no.
That usually inspires people.
No.
You know, it's not correct. Don't you want it to be correct?
Yeah.
And so, you know, and I'm thinking, I don't think I would have responded that way. I love input. I ask for input all the time. Like, evaluate it. Tell me how this went. What can I do better? I do that.
But how did you go back and correct that situation? Did you have a chance to say, okay, I'm sorry.
Oh, absolutely. I'm sorry. This is because they had never had anybody to do that. And I'd seen some previous year's reports, and it was one nonprofit, and they weren't well done. And I'm thinking, it's my first year on the job. This is going to be good.
Right. I'm going to prove.
I had just gotten there. It was my first year on the job. So I wanted them to know, this is what excellence looks like. We're trying to take the organization to another level. But it wasn't well received. And so I said, okay, I guess next time I should have sat with that person before I just changed it and published it.
Well, and from that, you state in the book four principles that you derive from those experiences. Listen, look, learn, and leave.
Yes.
Describe those.
Okay. So the Lord gave me these one night when I was totally brain dead. So I know it's totally from him. How to receive criticism. First of all, you listen. You don't interrupt. You know, when somebody's giving you feedback, you don't say, this is because I was doing this. I'll justify it. Just listen. All right. Same letters that spell silence, spell listen. So be quiet. Stop talking. And the other
that's good.
Look for the truth. Look for the element of truth in what that person is telling you. Learn from it. Be open. Seek first to understand. Don't just be defensive, but learn from it. And then leave the unwarranted part. Leave it. You don't have to embrace it just because somebody's telling you. Because sometimes people, they can be as wrong as two left shoes.
And so that's the untruthful part you can
just
discern.
You don't have to say, yeah, you're off on that one. Just don't say it. Just say thank you for that input. Because you know what that does? That positions you as a person who's open to input, and people would be more likely to give it to you. Once you've proven that you can't take that kind of input, nobody's going
to
tell you.
I totally agree with that. That's a management philosophy that I've tried to follow is, you know, let's just see the grains of truth and don't pay too much attention to the stuff that's emotional.
Right. And we don't like being, I don't like being criticized, and I don't like hearing the really bad parts, but I know it's good for me.
Especially those parts.
Yeah.
You also use an acronym PEACE that you use to describe how to overcome insecurity and find rest in God. I think this is a perfect place to end and transition to the questions, but what does PEACE, the acronym, stand for?
Well, we know that PEACE is the opposite of being anxious and being insecure. So the P is for prioritize every aspect of your life according to God's word. What's important to God? There's a certain amount of peace that comes with just knowing I'm doing the right thing. And then the E is for expect more from God. Don't stop expecting things from people. Expect more from God.
Well, that works in marriage.
Less from people. Oh, absolutely.
That's a good reminder.
Yeah, I want people to remember that. It's in Psalm 62. My soul, wait only upon God. My expectation is from Him. I'm only expecting God. My highest expectation is from God. A is acknowledge God in all of your decisions. Don't just make a decision in your own head. Acknowledge God. He will direct your path if you do that. And then C is to cultivate an attitude of contentment. That's hard because we're surrounded with things that say don't be content. And then E is to eliminate unrighteous behavior. And that's a daily battle. This is not something we just do one time and it's all done. It's a daily battle. And you know what? Because the Bible says righteousness and peace have kissed each other. Isn't that great?
It is good.
They have come together. There's an intimate connection between doing the right thing and experiencing the peace of God and not being insecure.
Deborah, this has been so good, but the time has flown by. We want to do a couple of questions and answers with our interns, the college students. So let's move to that and see what they're thinking about.
Love it.
I'm Jackson. I'm from Memphis, Tennessee, and I just finished up first year at Southern Seminary. When you were talking about the PEACE acronym and you said C, which was cultivate, I just feel like in today's culture, that's just becoming harder and harder, especially in the South, as it used to be almost a cultural advantage to cultivate a Christian environment. That is slowly quickly not becoming the case. So what tips would you recommend to help cultivate that better?
And that's cultivating contentment.
Cultivating contentment. So it starts with gratitude in the simplest things. You get up in the morning and you're glad that you have your right mind, that you're sober, that you love Jesus, that you have things, you have food. It starts with that. And you have to be intentional in knowing when something is coming against you that's going to cause you to be discontent. When you look at other people who may be excelling at a faster rate than you think you should, and you are a Christian, you have to bring yourself back. And I have certain anchoring scriptures. And one of the ones that I use is Psalm 139:16. All the days ordained for me were already written in God's book before one of them came to me. I am right where He wants me to be. And I want to be glorious in that space. I want to praise Him for where I am right now. So you have to be intentional.
Deborah, one of the things there, and I so appreciate the question, it's hard in cultivating contentment. That means you have to capture the discontentment.
Yes.
Meaning as you're thinking it, take it under control right there before you speak it, if you can.
Right. And don't speak it. Don't speak words of discontentment. Always be the one who's grateful. And let me tell you, discontentment is contagious. You can be in a bank and people say, oh, isn't this long? Nobody goes to the bank anymore. And then the grocery store, oh, look at this long line. You go, yeah. Well, you're just trying to be relatable, but you just encourage that.
Yeah. No, it's true.
So you have to be intentional. Always have some counter that you're willing to do and something you're willing to say that just lets your joy shine. You don't have to say, don't say that. You can just, I'm just grateful that I have the ability to come here and buy food.
Boy, and you know, the counter to all that is be content in all things.
Yes.
Oh, my goodness.
And the Bible says godliness with contentment is great gain. You're going to be so much farther ahead. When you just have that kind of a mindset.
Good discipline.
Yeah.
All right, next question.
Hi, my name is Mallory. I go to Milligan University in Tennessee. And you were talking about stepping out in faith when sometimes you don't feel like you have the experience or you don't have the degree, whatever, especially as a woman, and I'm sure I speak for other women here as well. But how do you step in those kinds of roles and maybe you're shot down or you're told that you don't have enough experience or you're not a right fit?
Well, first you get my book called Lead Like a Woman. But to answer your question right now, you have to just do it. You have to show up. What does that mean? Again, you have to apply for those things that are outside of your comfort zone. You have to learn how to sit in the front and raise your hand and ask questions. You have to learn to speak more powerfully because sometimes women don't come across as being confident. They measured 10 competencies of leadership and found out that women excelled in 8 of them more than men. But the two they don't excel in is confidence and risk-taking. So you want to show up and project confidence. And that requires some specific things. You speak more a little bit more loudly. You project. And you don't ask questions and say, well, you know, this may not be right. If you have an idea and you know it has some validity, then you state it. I think it would be great if we tried this. And you say it so that they can hear. Because I'm sure we've all experienced this, every woman out there. You're in a meeting or whatever. And you make a suggestion and they ignore you. And then a man comes right behind you and makes the same thing, and it's the greatest thing. I say maybe they didn't hear you, or maybe you weren't certain enough. And you don't have to act like a man to do that. You can just say, you know, let's try this. Jim, let's try this. I think this will work.
Let me say, I feel that way sometimes, though, too.
And so, then you need to read my book.
Somebody comes behind me and says something. I go, I just said that.
Yeah. But here's the thing. I got to give this as a great tip. I'm not kidding. It's a great tip. When somebody does that, rather than you turning around and say, did I just say that? You say, thank you for your support of my idea. Thank you so much.
Now, Deborah, for the students in the gallery right now, some of them don't have that opportunity because if I hear the question, she's saying, yeah, I can't even get some of these jobs.
Well,
is there an appropriate way to ask?
Okay. Yes.
She applies and she's told, no, you're not qualified.
Well, tell me exactly what I need to do to get qualified. What you know, because even when you've asked for a promotion or something, they say, tell me exactly what I need to do. You let your request be made known what you want in the first place. Be very clear. Yes, I'd like that position. Tell me what exactly I need to do so that I'm prepared for consideration next time because I really want it. It's okay to say I really want something. Sometimes we fear rejection and alienation and being told no. No isn't fatal. Say, okay, I didn't get it this time. Now tell me exactly what I'd like to do. And can I just depend on you from time to time? I want to pick your brain to see how I'm doing. Can we revisit this in 3 months? See, you have to be assertive.
This has been so rich and so good, Deborah. Thank you for being here. And one of the things we want to make sure people are aware of, because here at FOTF, fundamentally, we want you to have a relationship with Jesus Christ.
Yes.
We're a Christian organization. We love talking about marriage and parenting. We believe that's right from the Lord's heart, those institutions of family. And we want you to know who Jesus is. So if you don't have that relationship, get in touch with us. We have a great downloadable PDF booklet that's called Coming Home, and it really describes how to have that relationship with Jesus. In addition to that, let's get you a copy of Deborah's book, 30 Days to a Stronger, More Confident You. You can join us maybe monthly or a one-time gift, and we'll send you Deborah's book as our way of saying thank you for being part of the ministry team. Mm-hmm. If you can't afford it, we often do this. We believe in the content that Deborah's put together so strongly. We want you to have it, so don't let that be the barrier. We'll send it to you and trust others will cover the cost of that. So thank you for being with us today and listening to the great advice that Deborah's been able to provide.
Donate today as you can, and request Deborah's book when you call 800, the letter A and the word family, or click the link on your screen.
Deborah, as always, so good to have you with us. Thanks for being here.
Oh, it's been my pleasure, and I know the listeners are going to really go to another level.
That's good.
And on behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team, thanks for joining us today for Focus on the Family. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back as we once more help you and your family thrive in Christ.